devasanidhyam dehe me vardhatam hridi tavasyam deha yatrayam yenasya nirbhayodhaya sada ravinda satguru pada ravinda bhupika bhaje harmanata shriyo jaya prada surakshika Welcome to all the Veda lovers who have been hearing this exposition. I want to thank you for hearing all of these expositions. Today I will take up two topics. One is Rishis of the Veda and Upanishads, and the second is what you may call spiritual interpretation of Veda, what we know as the Adhyatma view of Veda. First, focus on the Rishis. All of you have heard of many Rishis, but we are focusing in the Puranas. We have all a lot of Rishis who are eager to give boons and curses and that sort of thing. So this is not what we are interested here. We are interested only in the Rishis of the Vedas, Rigveda proper, and the Upanishads. Therefore, what is the definition of Rishi for us? Who is a Rishi? Most important, I told you, every sutta, all the mantras are located in the supreme place called Paramatma. Somehow, by special powers, a Rishi gets access to those mantras. So, definition of mantra of a Rishi is one who has access to several mantras of this vast store. How does he do? He sees inside or hears inside antaradrashta. Remember, this is not physical, antaha, because that higher thing is also not physical. And what should he do? He transfers this to his physical memory. There, obviously, it stays. Therefore, later, when he is a disciple, what? He can recite the all the mantras he has learned on that occasion. I told you earlier, the Veda itself has no date, but the date when the mantra came out of the mouth of a Rishi has a date, I mentioned earlier. Therefore, lots of questions are there. How did the Rishis get this power? Just as, you know, I told you, the ordinary things, vast amounts of knowledge is stored on what you people call as the computer servers located at the bottom of the ocean. And you have a password, so which gives you the appropriate knowledge. Similar things, but not same. The password is a physical thing, but there the idea is the idea of a tapas, the shakti of the tapas that was makes the person become a Rishi. Remember, it's always the grace of God also, no tapas itself can guarantee any such thing. So if you want some tapas are in order, all of you know the Sanskrit word tapa means heat. And all of you know little cooking. Therefore, we have a bowl, it is heated by some gas heat and that sort of thing. We put water, always water and vegetables and whatever it is. We put some spices. Finally, a little bit of effort, we get your tasty sambar. But finally, ask the question, how was that final taste of the sambar came into being? That is this question. So, it is not we don't know. All the people may say, but we no. Therefore, the whole idea is tapas means the transfer of the divine energy of the Agni into the bowl of cooking to transform it into the edible and tasty form so that we human beings can enjoy it and live. So similarly, tapas means invoking the divine energies into our system. That is the whole idea of a tapas. Therefore, that is what they have to do. How do you do tapas? Most of you know Bhagavad Gita, 17th chapter, there is the tapasasa. So, the three types of course are there. Tamasika tapas, we don't care about it. Sattvika tapas, 17, 14, 15, 16. There is the tapas of, shall we say, the body, of the mind and the manas. So, in the idea of a tapas of the body, is sort of, you know, we should be clean both outside and inside. But also we should every day practice this habit of, shall we say, Swadhyaya. And the tapas of the mind says, you know, have this calmness. And speech says, don't say anything which hurts other people. Practice the habit of truth. The details are there. Therefore, the Rishis, these are the elementary conditions. They were practicing it all the time. In addition, if you see the biographies of great persons, you know, if you want to know about the physics, you have to ask a person in physics. Similarly, if you want to know about tapas, ask persons like the great disciple of Ramana, Vasishtha Ganapati Muni, or Kapali Shastriya, who did lot of tapas. One of the important aspects of tapas is take a mantra and repeat it 1,000, 10,000, 100,000 times, etc. Remember, this is one addition. Tradition, we have to do meditation now, so keep our the thoughts, dhyana, on this. Therefore, that both things are necessary. The idea of the repetition of a particular mantra done with bhakti all the time. Before, we should not be looking here, there and other things. Therefore, so first we have to do what is called the leading the life of a tapas, as I told you, leading every day certain things, being calm, always smiling, helping, always in some sense doing a little bit of seva, all these things are common. In addition, for days together, therefore people like Ganapati Muni, for they did a tapas for 21 days, 42 days and that sort of thing, then they stopped it. It is one session of tapas. So the Rishis did these sorts of things. Before that, they obtained the power. I told you again, tapas itself doesn't guarantee anything. It is the grace of the divine for some persons. Before the son of a Rishi need not become a Rishi also. That is this idea. Before the idea is, before this Rishi has an aspiration, a vipsa, athava in Kannada, akanksha, intense desire, and therefore he has access. So not all people have the same level of, some people may get 10 mantras, 10 people may get 100 mantras. A Rishi like Vasishtha had about, let us say, 400 mantras. That is this idea. It didn't come to him all at one time. It came to him in several occasions. But for example, the day, you see, as I told you, all the mantras didn't come at one time. They came over several centuries. Why? They are not speaking of one person, 400 persons, of which 30 are women also. Therefore, what happens? Therefore, what we have, let us take for example, the first sutta of the Rig Veda, it is due to our Madhuchanda Vaishwamitra, and he got in one stretch 10 sutras, about 100 mantras. Now there is no punctuation there. Remember, we are hearing an internal hearing. Zeen goes on and 100 are. Therefore, who does the division into particular sutta, particular numbers of mantra, where does it stop? For example, we say Agni Mile Purohidam Yajnasya Devam Rutvijam Hotaram Ratna Dhatamam Agni Purvetihi Rutnipihi Purvetihi Rutnipihi It goes on like this. But when do we say Thakaram, first Madhya, mantra ends, then the second mantra variant ends. All of it happens simultaneously by God's grace when He is invoking the mantra. That is when He is in the inner. Then it is transferred into the physical number. Then people say, how do you know who is this sort of person? Rishi done with it. Rishi himself is a very humble person. He doesn't put, Madhuchandas does not say, I am the sort of person. To me, mantra was revealed. What does the Rishi do? He recites it to the disciples. And they are also competent people. Once they hear, it becomes a part of their memory. So what these people do is, for every time when they hear a one section, they have a header for the entire thing. All of it was spoken by a particular Rishi, and then they give the name, and his father's name, and the lineage name. And also, not only that, they give a little bit more information to the Devata associated with it, the meter associated with it. Then later, people like Vyasa and others, they collected all of these things from different people and have what is called Anukramani, it gives a detailed list of all of these things. So, and how are the famous Rishis? We are all heard of the seven Rishis, that doesn't matter. But in the Rigveda itself, you know, we have the 10 mandalas, of which total number is about 10,500. About which, you know, the 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th and 7th belong to one particular family of Rishis. 2nd is Gritsamala, 3rd is our Vishwamitra, 4th is our Vamadeva, 5th is Atri and the all his disciples. I remember our popular deity, Dattatreya, Dattatreya, he belonged to the group. The 6th is the Bharadvaja and the 7th is the Vasishta. So, for example, your 5th mandala has all the Atreya disciples as well as the main Rishi Atri, Mahuma. For example, and the 1st mandala, the 8th mandala, 9th and the 10th have many Rishis. For example, the 1st mandala, the Rishi star, what is the name? Madhuchanda Vaishwamitra. Therefore, remember, what does it say? His name is Madhuchanda, his guru is Vaishwamitra. And the 11th Sukta there is by disciple of Madhuchanda, he is called Jeta. Remember, therefore, disciple means he doesn't become instantaneously. Must have spent hundreds of years doing tapas and that sort of thing. And therefore, the father of Vishwamitra also was a famous Rishi. His name is there, Sutas he composed are there. Therefore, with the Rigveda mentions 5 lineages of all of these people. So, we shouldn't jump into conclusion about the way it is arranged. Arrangement is one thing. And therefore, all of these important problem of Rishis, again, the famous lady Rishis are there. For example, there is a famous lady called Ghosha Kakshi Vadi is there. Therefore, and then another very famous lady is in the 10th mandala, 125th sukta, and she is the Vakambrani. Therefore, her father are Rishi Valabrana, therefore she is called Goddess of the Speech. I mentioned this name to you earlier also because in some sense it is said that she is one of the earliest Rishis whom a great god, Surya Savitri, revealed it. Therefore she revealed it to other persons and the list of the 50 number names in the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad I mentioned in many ways. Vakambrani is a very famous person. And her sukta is 10th mandala, 125th sukta. Therefore, it is worthwhile remembering that. Therefore, she uses, you know, she identified herself with all the devas. Remember, plural deva. I told you so many times. In the Indian tradition, We understand nothing happens by human being. Everything, even our body has millions of powers, each with a God. Therefore, he starts, Aham Rudre Vidhi Vasubhi Charami. I move, means I make the movement of the Vasus and Rudras, etc. Then she says an important word, Aham Eva Swayam Idam Vadami. I tell this myself, gods and all the people. He says, Yam Kamaye Tam Ugram Pranomi. Him whom I like, I make him a great person. Brahmana, Noyara Brahma, and a wise person. Like this, it goes very beautiful one. If you have the habit of reciting this sutta, every day it clearly helps you completely. So the point again is, we should make a habit, as I told you in the earlier session, of reserving half a day and that sort of thing. And don't complain in the beginning, I can't pronounce. As I told you, it's easy to pronounce. All you have to do is take a book in Kannada script and then focus on each of the individual words, a syllabus. For example, Agni Mire. First focus on Agnim Agni Mi. Focus upon that one. Just as, don't worry about compound syllables, that's also important. There is methods for it. Therefore, what happens is, when you dutifully sort of repeat these suttas, mantras, revealed to us by the sages, then the power of the gods manifest within us. The power of Agni manifests within me, of Indra, Mitra, Varuna, and of course the goddesses Saraswati, Mahalakshmi, and all of these. And what happens? Therefore, they simply don't keep quietly. They empower you to be creative in whatever things you do in your life. You take something. Our ordinary mind may give a little bit a bad idea, and then we say, hey, that's not correct. Think of other ways. And therefore, somebody else will come to you and give a solution to your big problem. Therefore, this problem of why we should repeat the Veda mantra every day is that we are going to get the divine energy. So, remember, we have to accept the idea. Millions and millions of devaha acting harmoniously. Therefore, if I repeat a mantra for Saraswati, our Lakshmi won't get angry or Indra won't get angry. For those of you who are all fascinated with the West, I have to tell you a small story. The Middle Ages in the Veda, in the Christian place, they have only one God. But there are so many forces are there. Then what did they do? They increase the number of devils. Do you know how many devils they had? 7.9 million devils. So many names they gave. Because they couldn't have more than one god. That is this idea. And that's how the whole culture was full of the devils' names. That is this idea. So just understand how we in our culture, we know good qualities, Indra, Agni, etc. They help us. So in contrast, that's what they did, because they started with the fundamental mistake, one God, one name. What about the other forces? They called all of them as the devils and etc. 7.9 million, remember, huge number. This number is quoted in one of the books, it's not my number actually, I can give a reference for it. Ram Swarup's book is there. So next question now, so you have a little bit of information about the Rishis. So what is the first thing you have to do, get up in the morning? You have to be, first thing you have to do is, I put my, of course you are sleeping on the cot, which is supported by the earth. Then you put your foot on the earth, say that, Bhumi, thank you are so wide, you are supporting me. And then of course you drink water, Apaha, thank you. And then of course warm water, Agni is there, and Surya is there, thank you. We name all of these gods, and then we have to name the Rishis. Oh Rishis, only because of your effort, I am reciting these mantras. If you did not do all the tapas and do all the work, where would I be? There would be no such thing.
Before we express our gratitude to all the Rishis and all the people who gave us the secret meaning of the Vedas. Next time, 3-4 minutes are there. So the idea in the Vedas, I told you, is it deals with outward meaning is there. And I give an example in the today itself. They follow, go be here, the Maya, go ho is not the cattle. It is the Jnana Rashmi, Adri is the negative force, destroys it, etc. So we can understand the entire Veda, all the 10,500 words of the verses, each has a meaning connected with the great spirit. What is the word in Sanskrit for spirit? Brahman, we say. Sarvam Kaluviram Brahman. So whom I am speaking now? I am speaking to all the people here who are Brahman. I am Brahman, you are Brahman. That is the whole idea, Sarvam. Therefore, that idea is there and all the gods are also Brahman. Therefore, every idea of mantra in the Veda has an outward meaning dealing with the rain and that sort of thing. The inward meaning, as I told you, Agni and others. Therefore, even in the olden days, they had the idea that there are three different levels, at least two different levels, outward and inward. But this was confirmed by the great teacher Madhvacharya. He was the only person among the three acharyas who wrote a detailed bhashya on the first 40 suttas of the Rigveda. And his follower Raghavendra Swami, he was the person who asked the question, how do we fix the meanings of the words? Later, but unfortunately, our Madhvacharya focused only on the, first 40 suttas, or 400 mantras. Then Swami added that it was, but most of us don't understand English anyway, therefore it was Sri Aurobindo who wrote his famous essays on the Veda, basically giving the secret meanings of the gods like Agni, Indra, Saraswati and their powers and others. They are in the book called the Secret of the Veda. But it was then people, the traditional pandits didn't agree. Oh, I know, Sri Aurobindo has his training in the West. So he is giving us the Western idea. Therefore, it was Upanishads here. His disciple, his great Sanskrit scholar. What did he do? He wrote a bhashya on the first 120 suktas, about 1400 mantras. Following he, how did he interpret each word? He uses the Panini's grammar. I have to mention here the great commentary by the great teacher Sainacharya. All of us, we should be very grateful to him because of him. If we apparently remember, he was the Prime Minister of our Vijayanagara Empire. He was not a pandit. He had so many, they were always fighting battles. Still, he engaged hundreds of pandits to do the work. His great contribution was preserving the text of the mantra and breaking them up into different words. And also giving the meaning of the ritualistic meaning of the mantra, which were popular at that time. So we should all be grateful for the great Sainacharya. We should not criticize him. But the point is that the interpretation, the spiritual interpretation is more useful now. Because who can do all the complex rituals given there? That's a different point. Therefore, all in all, we should be grateful for all of the commentators right now. And fortunately, Sakshi has translated all the 4-5 Vedas. You remember in the Rigveda, 10 mandalas are in the 12 books. Therefore, we have a text of the mantra. And what we do with each mantra, we divide it into 5 parts and give the meaning in 5 different sentences so you can understand. Then there is the Krishna Yajurveda, and then there is Shukla Yajurveda, and then we have the Sama Veda, 2 volumes, and Atharva Veda, most important, 6,000 mantras. In all, we have the 26 volumes are there. They are all in English, many of them are translated into Kannada also. The foremost of so people who say, we can't read English, don't worry, we have Kannada. Kannada, Tamil and Telugu. Now we have started doing Malayalam also. And of course, our basic books are essentials of Veda. Itar Veda, Sama Veda, Atar Veda, they are highly popular. And also we have brought beautiful books about God, the Ganapati, for example. The most popular God whom you worship. But are the spiritual interpretations of Ganapati, spiritual interpretation of Surya, and all of all these things we have given small books, 50 to 80 pages, therefore they can understand. Give the original Veda mantras also. Therefore, make a habit of don't say I don't understand. Take a small book. Don't take a big book. Don't take a big book. Take a small book. Indra Agni mantra. It use 20 page book. Therefore, it tells you the guidance to work at that sort of thing. Therefore, thank you for hearing me, patiently hearing me for all of these days. And hopefully, you will start repeating them in your house and get the great benefit. Thank you.